Okay, good morning. Welcome to worship. Have a cookie, a cup of coffee. Sit down and make yourself at home.
Welcome to worship. We are grateful that you are joining us today on this Mother's Day weekend. A special word of thank you to all the moms, grandmothers, sisters, aunts, and people who play motherly roles in our lives. We give thanks for you this day. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, we give you thanks for the opportunity to gather. Speak to us through your word. Remind us once again how blessed we are with your love, that we might share it with those we encounter. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All else to me, save that thou art.
good news come to us from the book of Revelation. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth has passed away. The sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, a new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. He will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
You'll see it multiple times in pretty much every college basketball game. One of the visiting players gets fouled, and he goes up to the foul line. And as he goes up to the foul line, the home arena just erupts in noise. They're stomping their feet, they're clapping their hands, they're shouting until they're hoarse, especially the fans behind the basket. They'll do whatever they can. They'll also make noise, but also wave their arms, and they'll dance, and they'll have signs that they move back and forth. Whatever they can do to distract the player. And that visiting player has got to shut off all of that noise. He's got to shut off all of those distractions and just step up to the line and do that really simple thing. That thing that he's done thousands and thousands of times before. He's just got to put the ball into the basket. Simple. In the same way, we've got to do the same thing when we read the book of Revelation. Revelation is a book filled with noise. It is a noisy book. I mean, just inside this book, there's a lot of things going on. There's, you know, beasts with four heads, and there's dragons, and there's Satan, and there's the harlot, and there's Babylon, and there's all of this stuff, horsemen of the apocalypse running around. There's a lot going on in the book. It's noisy. But outside the book too, there is a lot of noise, especially the last couple hundred years. There's some cultural noise around this book. There's rapture and tribulation and left behind books, all of this stuff. It is a noisy book. There's a lot of distractions. And somehow, as readers of this book, we've got to put away all of those distractions and just focus on one thing. The one thing, the thing that John, who had this vision and wrote it down and shared with the church, the thing that John wants us to hear, the message, the focus, the heart of this book. And we need to hear that message. It's a really important message for us to hear, just like it was for the people who originally heard it thousands of years ago. They were going through a rough time as a church. It was one of those times when people were not entirely sure the church was going to keep going for much longer. I mean, it varied from different area to area. Church was large enough that it was regional, but some regions of the church were struggling under persecution. Their neighbors, the government, hated them so much that they thought that they were just not going to survive. But some of the churches had the opposite problem. It was complacency. It was almost a little bit too easy. They lost the sense of their mission, of why they existed. And they just more were kind of fading into the distance. And then some churches had a real crisis of leadership. They had leaders, teachers, who were showing up and were not teaching helpful messages. They're not teaching the gospel, really. It was more about their own ego. It was about feeding their own thirst for power or whatever it is. All of these churches, however, were really struggling. And the whole church body as a whole had this existential crisis where they were not sure they were going to continue to be a church for much longer. And so there's a lot of people who loved the church. They loved Jesus. Their faith were, you know, right there in their chest. And they loved it, and it meant so much to them. They were steeped in it. And it was such a crisis to worry about this faith, which they wanted to pass on to their children and to their grandchildren. They wanted to see, you know, their communities just steeped in the love of God. They wanted that for the people they cared about, and to worry that that's just going to fizzle out. It's disheartening. It's hard to keep going. It's hard to keep fighting when you think it's all lost. When you think there's no real point to it because it's just all going to fade away anyway. When you think the darkness is going to win, it's a lot easier to just say, well, let's just call it. Let's just call it, go home, forfeit, whatever it is, and let the darkness, you know, take it away. It's easier than to keep fighting. And so the purpose of John's book, the reason why he wrote down his vision and shared it with the church, is to offer this hope that no matter how dark things might look, the light wins. No matter how much you may feel like you're surrounded by hatred, love wins. No matter if it feels like death has conquered all, no, life wins. The heart and purpose of the book of Revelation is to proclaim the good news that in the end, God wins. The people at the time needed to hear it. Of course, we need to hear it today too. We're in a very similar situation. We are experiencing a crisis in the church right now that I'm not a great historian, but it certainly feels to me like it is unprecedented. In the last 20 years, the church in North America has collapsed. One of the churches I served 13 years ago, no longer exists. When I left, there was a couple hundred people, and now there's just no one there anymore. Another church I know of had about 300 plus people worshiping every single week there about 10 years ago, and now it's like 85. No, we are collapsing as a church, and it is hard for those of us who love the church, who love Jesus, who want to share this good news, this hope, this faith that means so much to us with our children and our grandchildren and see them grow up in this loving, grace-filled community. And it's so hard for us to wonder what happens if it doesn't exist in 20 years, in 40 years, in 50 years, tomorrow. And so we need to hear this message again. But as a church, even though sometimes it feels pretty dark out there, sometimes it feels like we might as well just give in, just take our balls and our bats and just go home. Just forfeit to the forces of darkness and death and hopelessness. But the book of Revelation reminds us again and again that no matter how bad things look, God wins. No matter how dark it gets, the light wins. No matter how much we're surrounded by hatred, love wins. That's the promise. Yeah, things might be bad, but even if a dragon comes out of Lake Pepin and starts swallowing people up at Bay Point Park, we can keep moving forward in hope because eventually God wins. Even if the four horsemen of the apocalypse are circling around your yard, you can keep moving forward in hope. You can keep fighting the good fight. You can keep loving your neighbor. You can keep showing up in faith because God wins in the end. That's the promise of the book of Revelation. And it's not just a promise that the church needs, of course, it's a promise we all need to hear. It's anxious times that we live in. And I know a lot about this. About 10 years ago, I went through chemotherapy. It was pretty rough, but the rougher part was actually afterwards. So I was done with chemotherapy and my body was starting to heal a little bit. My hair was starting to come back. I was getting some energy back. But it messed with my emotions. And I remember there was a season of time where I experienced this intense anxiety. Like intense, like I'd never experienced anything like this before. It wasn't full-scale panic attack, but it was like I was right teetering on the edge of that at all times for a few months. It was really, really hard. And I remember like at one point, my friend Brett picked me up and just drove me like four blocks to go to that sushi place that used to be down by Subway. And as we're driving, it was just that sense of, oh, this is not safe. He's a safe driver, he's a fine driver, but just that absolute feeling like I am not going to make it to get my sushi. It's not gonna happen today. I remember one Saturday morning after a rough night, I called my friend Tim up and I just needed Tim to tell me it was going to be okay, to the point where I finally think, if I remember right, I think I actually told him to tell me this. Tim, just tell me that it's gonna be okay. Just say those words. Sometimes we need to hear that. And I think as a whole society right now, I just wish I could just sit down with every single person by person, and just let them know that love wins. Light wins. Life wins. God wins. I'd love to just be able to sit down with every single graduating senior as they look forward into a future, and so many of them just feel like the world is dark. And they just want to give up. And they don't want to face this darkness tomorrow and the next year. They've got a long life ahead of them. It just feels miserable and dark and scary. And I just want to sit down and let them know, no, listen, the light wins. As dark as it might seem sometimes, ultimately the light wins over the darkness. I would love to just sit down with every single person who is going through that season of life where it feels like all the people around them are dying, that they're going to so many funerals, and people that they love and know and care about and have known for their whole lives, they've got to say goodbye, and it just feels so heavy and permanent, and death just seems like it gets the final word. And I just wish I could sit down with every single one of them and just look them in the eye and say, no, listen, I know it's bad, I know it hurts, and I know that grief is real, but life wins in the end. Death does not get the final word. I wish I could just sit down with every young couple. And there's so many of them that they want to have kids. They've dreamed about having kids since they were young. They've got this whole idea of what it's going to be like to be parents. But they look around the world and it seems so filled with hate and so filled with violence. And it just feels like this crushing heaviness. So much so that they're not sure. They're not sure if they want to bring children into this world. And I just want to sit down and look them in the eye and say, God, love wins. Love wins over hate. Dear friends in Christ, life wins, light wins, love wins. So keep fighting the good fight. Keep showing up in faith. Keep looking forward to tomorrow. Keep trusting that what we do on this earth matters. Because in the end, God wins. Amen.
Faith of our mothers living yet in cradle song and bedtime prayer, in nursery love and fireside love, thy presence still pervades the air. Faith of our
thank you for your past giving, and especially this past year.
Here are the ways to continue that support: by text, by mail, by the online giving tab on the church website, and in the offering plate during worship. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your giving.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of
heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus
Christ, God's only Son,
our Lord, who
was conceived by the Holy Spirit,
born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under
Pontius Pilate, was crucified,
died, and was buried. He descended to
the dead.
And on the third day, he rose again.
He ascended into heaven
and is seated at the right hand
of the Father.
And he will come to judge the living
and the dead.
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy
Catholic Church,
the communion of saints, the forgiveness
of sins, the resurrection of the body,
and the life everlasting.
Amen.
I love
Creator, bless all those who care for creation and those who enjoy its beauty. Help all of us to care more deeply for the earth. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
God of justice, as we wrestle with racism and sexism in our society, grant us the willingness to learn from the experiences of others, the grace to grow, and fill us with a spirit of reconciliation for the sake of all. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Of all nations, we pray for our local, state, and federal governments. Help all of our elected officials and bless them with wisdom, humility, and desire to serve. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Good and gracious God, we pray for all those in need this day, including John Quist, Joyce Gustafson, Bev Ager, Laverne Thompson, Marion Lindstrom, Arlene Adolin, Sharon Becker, Orv Burma, Robert Derman, and all those we lift before you now, silently in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
May the love of the Father, the tenderness of the Son, and the presence of the Spirit gladden your heart and bring peace to your soul, this day and all days. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.